Jada, how are you?
Yeah, very good. Thanks, Ben. And how about you?
Yeah, it's really nice of you to take the time to speak to us today, and you're going to be giving us some advice about bodybuilding, is that right?
Yeah, well, what I'm going to do is basically point you in the right direction because you're a beginner.
Yeah.
And it's very hard for beginners because obviously there's so much information and they don't know where to look or where to go. So I want to make sure that you get off on the right foot.
Yeah.
So I'm free here to ask me questions.
Brilliant. So, yeah, I'm going to ask you some questions for myself, but I'm hoping it's going to be useful to our audience as well. I'm sure the answers will be applicable to the people that are going to be watching as well. So let's just begin. Just tell us a little bit about yourself. What is it you do, and what's your involvement with bodybuilding?
Okay, I'm a personal trainer, but I'm a slightly different type of personal trainer because I specialize in bodybuilding. So I specialize in muscle growth and fat loss and physical transformations. And for the past 3 years, I've been putting together material so that this can be replicated and taught to anybody. So I also train personal trainers to specialize in physical transformations. So that's my area of expertise.
All right, fantastic. And how long have you been doing this?
I've been doing this for 4 years now as a career. I've been training personally for 15 years. And well, yeah, that's it basically, yeah.
Okay, and you're based in Weston-super-Mare, United Kingdom.
Sunny Weston-super-Mare by the
Okay.
sea.
All right, we're going to put your email address up so people can contact you if they want to. So let's take me as a case study, as a sample specimen. So I'm just a beginner. I really don't know much about bodybuilding. I just want to kind of, I don't really know what I want. I just want to get in shape and feel good and look good, and that's all I know. So what's your first sort of thoughts on that?
I mean, to begin with, there's a lot of basics you need to get right. The first thing is you need to make sure your exercises are being performed properly. The great thing is we've got YouTube now, and if you've got a routine to follow and you're not sure how to do the exercises, you can look on YouTube, and there's generally quite good videos on keeping good exercise form. Most of them are okay. And also making sure that you're starting off in the right foot when it comes to diet, getting some basic and fundamentals right with food, making sure you're getting a good routine to start with that you can follow. So
Right.
that's where I'd start somebody.
Okay, so tell us about some of the mistakes that, beginners might make if they don't know what they're doing. What's the typical mistakes you see?
Okay, typical mistakes are number one, overtraining. People have this idea that more is better. And it's just complete opposite. Better is better, and better generally means training less than you think you need to. Very often people will go, okay, I need to train 5 days a week, and they're a beginner, and that's not going to get you anywhere. You're going to be overtraining. You're not going to get to full recovery. So that's one mistake. Another mistake is that they read a bodybuilding magazine and they see these routines that the top bodybuilders in the world are doing. And they don't take into consideration things like these top bodybuilders are taking huge amounts of drugs. So their bodies are performing very differently to a normal natural person. Another thing that they don't take into consideration is the fact that these bodybuilders have been training for many, many years, and they've already developed themselves to a very high level before they do those types of routines. So a beginner will come in, look at this typical bodybuilding routine, 10, 12 reps or even higher, lots of sets, lots of high volume, and splitting the body parts over 5 days and going to the gym and just training as hard as you can. And after a few months, they don't get anywhere and they wonder what it is. And it's simply that they're overtraining and they're doing a routine that's not suited to them.
Right, okay. Right. So let me ask you a question then. So I've got this sort of basic understanding that you work on different muscle groups and you split it over different days or something. So let's just say, for example, let's say I was working on chest and triceps or something like that. So how long should I wait until I work on that muscle group again?
Okay, generally for a beginner, as long as you're eating properly and you're resting and you're not kind of like burning the candle at both ends, as it were, then for a beginner, hitting a body part every 7 days will be okay. As you become more advanced and your training sessions get tougher, and they get a much higher level of intensity, then you may need longer rest time. Of course, this is all very general because we've got to take in lots of factors like genetics. Some people are genetic freaks. They grow really well. They recover really well. Most people won't be a genetic freak. They'll have average genetics. So for the average person, training a body part once every 7 days to begin with will be fine. But as they get more advanced, and especially if they start training for strength, because strength training or training to get stronger is a lot harder on the body and you can take longer to recover.
Right. Okay, you've already taught me something. I've realized something I'm doing wrong. So I've been like 3 days and then doing the same muscles again. So that's too soon, is it?
Yeah, you're not going to be you're not going to be, you train a body part, you allow it recovery time. It might ache, stops aching, and people think the muscle's recovered.
Right.
The muscle ache is no sign of the muscle recovering at all. So yeah, if you're doing it every 3 days, yeah, you're not going to see a difference by the next workout.
Oh, right. Okay, I've definitely been making that mistake. I thought as soon as it stops aching, it's ready to go again.
Yeah. No, I mean, I say to people, generally, if you leave it 2 to 3 days after you've stopped aching, then you're going to be approaching full recovery.
Right.
There's a difference between feeling recovered and reaching full recovery, where the muscle has then adapted from the previous workout.
Right. So what do you mean the... So what does full recovery mean and adapted? What does that mean?
If you've trained correctly, you've trained the muscle to a point where it's gone up to its maximum capacity and it's actually been overloaded. Okay? Once it's been overloaded, it's broken down on some level. It's overworked. It's like a car that you've ranted the engine and it started to break down. So it then has this dip of performance. If you trained a muscle and then tried to train it the next day, then you wouldn't be able to because the performance would have dropped because it's damaged, it needs to repair. Right. So you leave it time to repair, you've stopped taking, feels like it's recovered. If you train a little bit too soon, it means it hasn't fully built itself back up again.
Oh, right.
If you get your timing right and leave it a little bit longer, then you will notice a difference in the performance from the previous workout. You might get an extra couple of reps. You might lift an extra 2.5 or 5 kilos. Do you see what I mean?
Right. Okay. Got it. Yeah. That makes sense. That's really interesting. So, and also, let's say it stops aching after 3 days or whatever, and then you leave it another 3 days. So 7 days since you worked it out. Is it going to have grown in that time after it stopped aching as well? Is that where it grows? I don't know.
Well, if you're training naturally, then muscle growth is going to be such a gradual process. If you're looking in the mirror every day expecting to see changes, you're not going to notice them. A, because you're looking every day. This is why I recommend to people when they start training and they're going to get serious is take some before pictures and then take regular pictures round about every 2 months to 3 months, because that's enough time period to notice half an inch here, an inch there in size. But if you increase your chest size in an inch in 3 months, that's a good increase. But if you're looking at yourself every day, an inch, you're not going to notice that. And you might think to yourself, well, hang about, an inch on my chest in 3 months, that's a very small amount of growth. Well, that's 4 inches on your chest in a year.
Yeah.
That's a big increase in muscle mass.
Yeah. Oh, okay. All right. That's really interesting. Yeah. Okay. So now tell us about this intensity and overloading the muscle thing, because I don't know. I don't really know anything. So...
It's okay, intensity and overloading a muscle. Okay, I think what I should do is go to some real basic concepts here. And the first basic concept to really understand is that the muscle can grow in two separate ways. Okay, the muscle can get stronger and you'll get a small increase in size, but the muscle can also get bigger and volumize, but without any increase in strength. I'll just separate these two in your mind. You've got strength training on one side, and you kind of got bodybuilding on the other. And we kind of all know of people, have heard of people, where someone's stronger than they look, and then you might get a bodybuilder that's not as strong as he does look. And it's simply because one's grown his muscle more in that direction, and this person's grown his muscle more in that direction.
Right.
So when it comes to training, what's best for a beginner is to learn to train really well for strength. And when you've got stronger and you can train like that, then learn to do bodybuilding.
Right.
And then you'll create growth in both directions and you really will maximize your muscle size.
Got it. So there's a difference between strength and size. It's two different things.
Yeah. Yeah, you can train for strength and you will get a bit bigger.
Yeah.
But it's not until you switch your training to the other type of muscle growth, which is what bodybuilders aim for, that you can then pump up the muscle.
Right. Now, I was reading, you very kindly sent me an article that you wrote. Is that, by the way, do you sell that or is it available to people?
That's a free, I give that free to beginners and any clients. I give that as like an introduction just to get them going.
Oh, okay.
Basically.
So if anybody's watching this, we can put the link or you can send it to them.
Yeah, okay. Definitely.
So I was reading that just before we spoke today, and I kind of got a loose understanding. Like if you do higher reps, then that's more to do with building the size of the muscle. Whereas if you do heavier weight but lower reps, that's more to do with the strength.
Strength, correct. That's right. Correct.
Okay, so what does that mean in terms of my workout routine then? How do I apply that?
Okay, well, you're a beginner, so as a beginner, you need to build a foundation of strength. If you start trying to go into a bodybuilding routine, you're trying to pump up nothing. There's nothing there to pump up. So you need to develop some strength in the muscle first. Once you've built some strength, then you can pump what you've got and pump it up. Okay, so I would put every beginner, I'd put them on a strength training routine. And then teach them how to get stronger first. So that's probably where we should focus and kind of talk about and the rules and how to go about that.
So you'd start off with lower reps, higher weight to build strength.
Yeah, yeah.
Right, and that's going to build like a foundation.
Yeah.
That you can then pump up more afterwards.
At a later date, that's right. I mean, if you look at bodybuilders that are incredibly successful and become the best at what they do, every single one of them started off developing strength first. I mean, Arnold Schwarzenegger is a good example. He was a powerlifting champion, and he got into his strength training and his powerlifting before he moved to bodybuilding. Ronnie Coleman is another Mr. Olympia. He started off as a powerlifter and a strength trainer, then moved into bodybuilding. And you'll find that's a common theme. The biggest, most advanced bodybuilders build strength and then they pump up the strength.
Right. Okay. And what about you? Like, what does your type of routine, like, what do you focus on, or do you do both?
Well, what I generally do, I do a combination of both styles of training in one workout, but I can only do that because I've mastered strength training and I've mastered bodybuilding. If a beginner tried to train the way I train, they wouldn't really be able to do it effectively enough because they wouldn't know the difference of what they're actually doing in the gym. For example, I'll do a set on bench press, and the first part of the set will be strength training. The second part of the set will be pumping up and bodybuilding and hitting one part of the muscle, then hitting the other part of the muscle, all in one ginormous set.
Oh, I see. So it is possible to do it all in one session if you know what you're doing.
If you know what you're doing and you know what each way of training feels like, then you can do both in the same session. But you'd have to be advanced to do that.
Oh, I see what you mean.
Never recommend that.
So because you've already got a foundation of strength that you've already built up, you can do the strength and pump it up as well, sort of thing.
Yeah, it's not because I've just done it. It's also because I know how it feels.
Right.
Because bodybuilding is if I was to say what is it in essence, it's about tuning into your body to a completely different level. You've got to tune into how your body feels, and strength training feels a certain way, and you know when you've trained a muscle and you know when it's failed and you've overloaded it because you're straining through strength. And then it's a different feeling again when you're straining the muscle because it's running out of energy, which is a different feeling again. So unless you've mastered both styles of training and you tried to do both at the same time, you wouldn't really know what you were doing correctly.
I see. That's completely new information to me. So it feels differently to exhaust it with weight as opposed to like exhausting it with
energy. With, yeah.
Oh, I
mean, the bodybuilder goes for a lactic acid burn. They go for the pump. They pump and pump and burn, burn, burn. Very painful, sharp burn. And they have a very short rest, and then they do it again. Burn, burn, burn. They're just constantly striving for that lactic acid burn and that build-up of that sensation in the muscle. It's very painful. And that's what they're chasing, to pump up the muscle. It's all about energy. So, whereas the, yeah, go on.
Oh, sorry to interrupt. So when you say, like, the lactic acid burn and the high reps, is that, like, say, for example, I was doing, like, an endurance type of thing, like running for ages or something, or I don't know, or I don't know, like cross trainer. I don't know. No, hang on. I'm losing my words now. Okay, I don't know what I'm asking. Just carry on.
Okay, what was I saying? Yeah, the bodybuilder. So that's the bodybuilder's good for that. And that feels, you know what that feels like, and that feels a very certain way. And you have to train in a specific way to get to that point, to make the muscle behave in that way. Strength training is completely different in how it feels. It feels completely different. Now, I'm going to bring in another fundamental point that all beginners must understand. And as we spoke earlier about bringing the muscle to the point of overload, and once it's reached overload, the muscle is then ready to adapt. It's ready to, you've started off the growth process. Training must be viewed as like the spark to start off the growth process. The diet and nutrition is like the ingredients to carry it on. And then the rest and recovery is where it's all finished off.
Right.
So if you're going to train to get stronger, you need to overload that part of the muscle, and that feels a certain way. If you're going to train to pump up the muscle, you must overload the muscle in that way, and that feels a certain way.
Okay, so let's just use me as an example. So recently I've been doing kind of like 3 sets of 8 reps, about as much as I can do, like 8 to 10 reps or something like that, and then I can't really do any more. So is that appropriate for strength training?
This is great. This is another common mistake made by beginners, is that they train in such a way where they're kind of trying to do a bit of both, but not really doing either properly.
Okay.
It's such a common mistake. Like, strength training has very as a set of rules, like how many reps you should stick with, how long you rest between the sets, and things like that, and how many sets you should do on a body part. Strength training has those rules. Bodybuilding and pumping up to cause that type of growth has different set of rules, is different rep range, a different rest period, a different total number of sets, and they're both different. So what you've mentioned there, you're kind of trying to do a bit of both.
Okay.
And so you're not really doing either very well.
Okay. Okay, so what, so tell us what proper strength
okay, so some real basic fundamentals for strength training. Let's stick with the real basics. The first one is the rep range. You want to stick to a rep range around about 4, 5 to 6 reps. Oh. Once your rep range is that low, you're handling your heaviest weights you can handle. And without going too technical, you're going to stimulate all of your muscle fibers, and you're going to stimulate the muscle in the correct way. Now, so that's rule number one. Stick between the sort of no more than 6 reps. If you're getting to 7, 8 reps, then just put the weight up slightly until you're struggling to get to 5 or 6. Okay? If you're going for 10, 12 reps, then you're moving towards bodybuilding. Okay? So that's rule number one. Rule number two, you need to make sure that your rest time between sets is long enough. And this is a big mistake for people when they're trying to get stronger, is they do a set and they warm up and then they rush to do their next set. You want to rest for about anywhere from 3, 4, or even up to 5 minutes between your sets when you're strength training.
Right.
Whereas a bodybuilder will do the complete opposite. He'll rest for like a minute or even 30 seconds. Okay. If you don't get that rest time, then you're not letting the energy recover in the muscle, and you're not going to be as strong. So you need to make sure that rest time is there.
Right. Okay. All right. All right. I'm learning a lot here, because that's, yeah. Okay. So basically, just using me as an example, if I'm doing strength, which basically I should be by the sound of it, I should be doing a higher weight for lower reps, 4, 5, or 6 reps, and then resting for several minutes. Like, what was it? Up to 5 minutes.
About if you're a beginner, between 4 to 5 minutes. That sounds like a long time, but in between that time, you should be mentally preparing yourself. Right. You should be getting yourself into a powerful state of mind. You should be, you know about NLP and states. Well, when you're training to get stronger, there's no point standing there with your shoulders hunched over, like sat on a chair. You're not just sat there. Wait, you should be stood up. You should be pacing up and down. You should be thinking about the muscle you're about to train. You should be connecting to it. You should be getting focused and building yourself up. So when you do that set, you're really putting everything into each individual rep.
So by just doing the level of weight where I'm doing 8 or 10 reps, that's really neither strength building nor bodybuilding. It's like,
yeah, kind of a bit of in between.
It's a bit of in between, and that's not effective. You're saying it's better.
You will get some results, but you're not really concentrating on being effective in either way.
Right. So okay. So I'm not going to get the best results that I can.
No.
Right. I
no.
see.
You'll find it. You will find it very hard to. Once you get to a point, you'll find it very hard to get stronger because you're not strength training particularly well, and you're not going to really pump anything up because you haven't really got much to pump up.
Yeah.
Anyway, and that's not very effective rep range to pump up either.
Okay. Wow. Okay. So I've learned loads there because. I thought, yeah, that so, and I, in my mind, I was thinking that, like, bodybuilding would be, like, when you say pump up, I'm thinking, like, 20 or 30 reps or something.
a little bit too hot. I mean, some bodybuilders go up to sort of 15
right, okay,
reps,
so.
But I think generally, you're going to, if you're going on a bodybuilding, you're going to pump. There's no point in pumping unless you've got strength.
Yeah.
But if you are strong and you have developed strength and you've never tried bodybuilding or pumping the muscle up, then go for the sort of 10 to 12 rep range with a very short rest, and then you'll feel the burn and then keep chasing that burn.
Right. So, okay, so how do you split your workouts up, you know, like over
body
different
parts.
Days?
Yeah. Body parts. I found it more beneficial to for most people to split the body part into three sections. And what I do, I use all of the pushing muscles in one session, which is your chest. So I use three exercises for chest, for the middle, upper and lower chest. I use the front shoulders, because that's involved in all pushing. I'll do an exercise for the front shoulders, and again the triceps, because the triceps are involved in all pushing movements. And that's one workout.
Yeah.
The next split will be all the pulling muscles. Okay. So I'll do the upper back, lower back and the middle back. And I'll do the side shoulders, because the side shoulders are involved in pulling. And I'll do the rear shoulders and the biceps, because the biceps are involved. So that's all the pulling muscles. And then the lower body, which would be all of the leg muscles.
Oh, I see. So for like, if you were working with a client, for example, someone like me, you'd split it into three different things like that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I just had a question came into my mind then, and then it just went... What was I going to... Oh, yeah. Look, so let's take, for example, you mentioned the pulling type of motions. So that would be like biceps and back and type of stuff. So how many different exercises within that would you do?
If you're strength training, the volume of the workout or the amount of exercises is quite low. It's not about volume. It's about weight and it's about strength.
Right.
Whereas bodybuilding is about volume. So... This is how it is best done. When you're a beginner or when you're advanced, you want to start your workout off with real heavy basic exercises. So you start off with the biggest muscle. So on your pushing muscles, it's going to be your chest. Okay, so you'd start off with a real basic exercise. No point going on the machine that isolates the muscle. Go on the bench press. Use dumbbells or a bar. Because you're using your maximum weight and it's a big exercise and you're going to get a much better hormonal response. Whereas if you go on a machine and you're isolating the muscle, you're not getting that hormonal response. It's not a big exercise. So start off with the main body part on big basic exercises. Then as the workout progresses, you can then switch to isolation exercises on lighter weights and finish off what's termed the secondary muscles. So take, for instance, in the bench press, you're going to be pushing. This is the primary muscle. Front shoulders is a secondary muscle, and triceps are a secondary muscle. So you're in effect, when you're doing your chest anyway, you're warming up the shoulders and the triceps, so they don't need too much to finish off. So generally, if you're strength training, you do about 6 sets on your chest, a couple of sets on your front shoulders, and about 4 sets on triceps.
Oh, I see. So that's like 3 different sort of things, and that's it, basically. If you're doing that. So if someone like me is doing that, we shouldn't be doing like a dozen different things on a dozen different machines. We should just focus just on like 3 things and do them properly.
Yeah. Keep it simple.
Right. So there's no point going all around the gym, having a go on everything. And
no, right. Not at all. Okay. Not at all. I mean, if you want to do that, that's fine. But, you know, yeah. Depends if you're interested in getting stronger.
Yeah. All right. Oh, I see. Okay. So, all right. Yeah, I'm learning loads. This is really great. Okay, I'm not sure what to ask yet. I know. No, I know what I was going to ask. You mentioned hormones, and I got no idea what you mean. What was that about?
Okay, do you know what a hormone is?
Well, yeah, I mean, yeah, I know what it is, but how does that relate to?
Okay, when you train, you're going to have what's called a hormonal response to how you train, and certain exercises will give you a much higher peak in hormones, like testosterone and growth hormone. These are your hormones that are considered anabolic hormones. Also, they give you an increase in adrenaline and androgenic hormones, things that help you get more focused for your training. And those are the big, heavy compound exercises, like bench press and squats and deadlift and things like that, the real basic exercises. My advice to a beginner would be definitely stick with the basic barbell, dumbbell exercises as much as you possibly can.
Right. So trying to get fancy and complicated really isn't going to...
No.
That's not going to help anything, right?
I mean, also for strength training, the basic exercises are best for strength training. When you switch to bodybuilding, then you can start to use the machines and the cables and the isolation exercises a little bit more, because they're much more suited to that kind of focus and targeting a muscle, whereas strength training is more about basic heavy lifting.
Right. Oh, I got it. Okay, so just as a general rule of thumb, if we're doing strength training, it's like less exercises, but the main muscle groups. And then if you're doing the bodybuilding, you're doing you're more isolating different things and pumping them up. Is that?
Yeah, that's it. Yeah.
That's a general rule of thumb. Okay.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. Wow. Okay. This is great. This is really interesting. Now, okay, just a complete change of topic. Nothing to do with what we were just talking about, I don't think. I've been watching, you know, the guys that do the bar stuff, the parallel bars, Hannibal for King.
Oh, yeah. In the park. Yeah, they're nuts. they're amazing. Crazy. Amazing.
I mean, I don't know. It just looks cool. I find it kind of appealing just because it looks cool. Like, I just sort of... maybe I want to do that. What's your comments on that type of thing?
If you want to do it. I mean, really, if you're going to concentrate on building muscle, then concentrate on that. What they're doing, they've been doing it for years and years and years and years. You see, people watch the videos of those people on the bars, and they see their physiques, and they kind of go, oh, wow, they've got great physiques, and they just play about on those bars. Well, no, they've been doing that for like 10 years, and they've been doing it since they were little kids, and they've built themselves up and built themselves up.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if you want to play around and do that, that's fine. I wouldn't do anything other than concentrate on specifics. So if you're training to get stronger, concentrate on that, get stronger. After you've built some strength, then go play around and do that if you want to.
Right. I see. So they cut. It looks easier than it is. They've got a lot of history behind them to be able to do that.
Yeah.
I see what you mean. Okay. I just remember something I was going to ask you. Fat. Mm. Like most guys, you know, you can't see my abs because there's kind of a layer of fat over them. So what's your advice to losing body fat?
Okay, body fat. I mean, you're interested in bringing your abs through, yeah, and getting a six pack. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay, well, rule number one with six pack is, first of all, going back onto the muscle building side of it, is your stomach muscles are the same as any other muscle in your body. So training your stomach muscles every day and doing 50 or 100 sit-ups every day, it's going to create a little bit of condition and a little bit of something there. But if you want to seriously grow your abs, you're going to have to train them like every other muscle group.
Right.
Which means you're better off hitting them once a week. You need to build strength in them first, and then you need to kind of pump them up afterwards.
Right.
So that's the muscle side covered. But the fat loss side is all about speeding up your metabolism.
Right.
Okay. There's certain foods and real basics that you need to kind of stick to. And like one of the most important ones is keeping to a low GI diet. GI stands for glycemic index. Glycemic index is the rate at which foods turn to sugar when they hit your stomach. So you want to cut sugars or high GI foods completely out of your diet, because the sugar, just remember this, sugar turns to fat like that.
Right.
Fats, good quality fats in the body, very rarely get turned to body fat.
Right. Right. Okay.
Sugar makes you fat.
So
white bread, white pastries, white pasties, anything refined.
Right.
Even if you had like a bowl of white rice, but you had a big bowl like people tend to, well, that's within a few hours, that's going to be a lot of glucose getting into your blood. It's going to be really high GI. Your body's not going to know what to do with it apart from turn it to body fat.
Right. So it's the sugar in our diet, the refined sugar that's actually causing the fat, not like the fat on a piece of meat.
That's one part of the equation. Very often when people just switch to a low GI diet, they start to get amazing fat loss results. When a bodybuilder gets ready for a show, they will go through different phases, and sometimes there'll be like 3 or 4 stone of body fat overweight because they've been bulking up during the winter and just enjoying eating lots of crap food. The first thing they do when they're about 3 months away from the show, the first thing is they cut the crap out. They cut the sugar out. They cut the high GI foods out, the pizzas, the pastries, the pasties, the pies, the cakes, chocolate, sweets, anything like that. So you have to go low GI if you want to start, if you're serious about fat loss.
Right, okay. So if I cut out the sugar and the chocolate, that's going to help me to lose fat. I snack on nuts and stuff. Is that okay, do you think?
Yeah, snacking's really good because snacking gets your metabolism going faster. And this is the other basics that people don't understand. And that is fat loss is all about getting your metabolism working faster. I mean, let's take it really simple. We all know somebody that eats or drinks and just is constantly putting shit into their body, yet they're skinny as anything. That's because their metabolism is ridiculously fast.
Right.
And we all know somebody as well that doesn't eat too much at all, and they even try and eat healthy, and yet they're as fat as a house.
Yeah.
And it's very easy to tell how someone's metabolism is by their demeanor. Like someone that's overweight and has got slow metabolism, they're kind of walking into the room very slowly, and they sit down, and when they're sat down, they kind of stay sat down. Whereas someone with a fast metabolism would be coming into the room and looking around and flitting around, and they have a lot of more nervous energy. But you can speed up your metabolism. I took a client a couple of months ago. He's lost 3 stone in 2 months and kept all of his muscle. And up until that point, he had tried all kinds of diets, he had tried all kinds of things, and he couldn't lose fat. As far as he was concerned, he was fat for life. So I said to him, the first thing we need to change is your belief of what's possible. So I showed him lots of examples of people in the same situation. Then he started to come around to the idea, and I said, right, the next thing we need to do is we need to speed up your metabolism. We can do this, we can do this, we can do this, and we can do this. So that's one of the most important things too.
Mm. Okay. Right, so we can speed up the time. Okay, so you got me thinking. Right, there's something else I want to ask you. I kind of enjoy just like, you know, running on the treadmill and just sweating. It just feels good. It's just like,
yeah,
feels good. And I like going to spin class.
Yeah.
And so what do you call that? That's called...
It's called cardiovascular exercise, yeah. But, you know, it's a bit of a loose term, really, because that... I do cardiovascular exercise, but the type of cardiovascular exercise I do is very different to what most people do. I do a form of cardiovascular exercise which is very high in intensity. What I generally do is I find a very steep hill, sort of as steep as you can get, sort of around about that, something that's a struggle to walk up. And for me, I it's about 60 meters, I'll warm up, and then I'll sprint up it as fast as I possibly can until I'm forced to stop. And then I stop for a few minutes, catch my breath back, and I do that another 2 or 3 times.
Right.
It's very, very intense. At the end of that, your lungs are really, really panting.
Right.
But it's a lot more... It's a lot harder than kind of like doing normal cardiovascular exercise. It's very intense.
Okay, right. So if I'm going to spin class and stuff, is that helping me? Is that generally good? You know, is that a good thing to do?
Yeah, spin's pretty good. Again, you adjust the resistance yourself in a spin class. And if I was going to do a spin class, I would do them much shorter and make the people put the resistance on their bike much higher so they worked much harder,
right,
rather than spacing it out over 45 minutes or an hour. You know, it's good, yeah. But... If you was to do it yourself, you could make it more intense. You see, the reason to make it intense is to get your hormones running higher. and to get you get the right hormones running higher. You see, the thing is, if you're doing endurance type exercise and it's going over about 45 minutes, half an hour, your body's not only releasing certain hormones that are beneficial, but it's also releasing hormones which are detrimental to your health, such as cortisol.
Right, okay. Okay.
Sorry, gone a bit too deep, bit too quick.
Okay, no, let's take this one step at a time. So, yeah. Okay, we'll come back to the cortisol thing. So, hold on a second. So, when I get to the end of a 45-minute spin class and, you know, and I'm sweating and et cetera, and my muscles are probably burning or something, or they might be the next day, is that building muscle or what? What's that doing for?
No, that's not building muscle. It's endurance. So you're exercising your lungs, your ability to pump oxygen around the body. You're primarily using a sort of a low level part of your muscle tissue, which is endurance based.
Okay. So it's burning doesn't mean that's not building the muscle just because it's burning. That's a separate thing, is it?
I mean, if you're getting a bit of a lactic acid burn, it's going to build a small amount of muscle, but because the weight's not there and it's too close to endurance rather than going the other way.
So it's more the heart and the lungs and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
Okay. So the cortisol thing you just mentioned, that I got no idea what that means. So.
Cortisol is a hormone which is very, very, very detrimental to health. It's called the death hormone. The body releases it in a stressful situation, but long-distance endurance exercise can release a lot of cortisol. And cortisol actually breaks down muscle tissue to convert it into energy. It ages you. Cortisol ages you. It's when you get stressed, you release shitloads of cortisol. And the thing is about cortisol, not only does it age you and it robs your muscle tissue and breaks it down, but it also slows down the fat burning process.
Okay, right. Okay, hang on. Just one step at a time. So when you see a politician that's been in office for 4 years and they look sort of 10 years older.
That's cortisol.
That's stress. So that relates to stress and that sort of thing. Okay.
That's why the worst thing you can do is wake up in the morning and have a cup of coffee on an empty stomach, because cortisol rises sharply in the morning. So to knock it out, you want a good breakfast and that will knock it back out. But what most people do, they avoid breakfast and then they take a stimulant.
Yeah.
Like coffee and on an empty stomach, and then their cortisol is already rising. Have a coffee, boom, shoot, sky high, and they feel brilliant because they're buzzing off of this hyper energy rush that they're getting, which is adrenaline and cortisol. It's like the fight or flight hormone is kicked right in, and they love it. And then they get to lunchtime, they have a big crash, have another coffee, have some sugary food to get the blood sugar back up. Very bad for the body, very bad for health, very bad for fat burning. In fact, puts fat burning in the opposite direction, makes you store body fat.
So you said that can break down muscle, can it?
Yeah, cortisol breaks down muscle. It robs your muscle tissue. And it sees that you're in a fight or flight situation. Yeah. That's why it's being released. And in a fight or flight situation, you might need to go days or weeks without food. So muscle is not that important. So that gets put up. Well, let's break the muscle down because we've got more than enough of it anyway. But let's store the body fat because you might need that in a few weeks.
Right. So does that relate to adrenaline?
Yeah, it's cortisol and adrenaline are both kind of like similar fight or flight hormones. I'm not sure about the exact relationship, but they're both can release at the same time.
So let's say, for example, like a martial arts or a boxer or something where it's very competitive and very high adrenaline or something, is that going to involve a lot of cortisol?
Yeah, it can do, but time's a factor.
Right.
So if you're going to go on a 4 mile run. And you haven't eaten right beforehand, you haven't taken certain foods, and you're really going for it and it's quite stressful, then half an hour might be all right, but after about 45 minutes to an hour, your stress hormones might be starting to rise a bit more. This is why I keep cardio very, very intense and very short,
right?
Because it doesn't give my body a chance to start releasing those stress hormones to any high degree.
So what about something like a marathon? Is that more likely to be stressful?
That's going to be very stressful on the body.
Right.
If you look at the studies of these very long endurance sports and what it does to the body goes into all kinds of emergency states. And if you look at a marathon runner and what they physically look like, they can still have a little bit of blubber on them, but they have no muscle and they look really gaunt and they look quite aged.
Yeah. Yeah.
You look at a sprinter and look at their physiques and what sprinters look like, it's completely the opposite direction.
So why does the body go into this fight or flight cortisol thing? Why does it become stressed by the long endurance thing then?
Don't know, you got me there.
Okay.
It's the way it works.
Okay. So if we participate in a football match or a spin session, are we in danger of putting our body into that situation?
I mean, I am kind of like erring on the side of a bodybuilder. A bodybuilder is going to want to minimize cortisol completely.
Right.
A person that's not concerned about keeping muscle mass and maintaining maximum muscle mass, it's not really going to make too much difference.
Okay.
Certain things, like I said, about not having a breakfast and having a coffee as a breakfast, things like that you want to avoid, even if you're not a bodybuilder.
So why is it that eating the breakfast helps with, to avoid cortisol? Then?
Because in the morning, cortisol starts to rise sharply. Mm. Once you start to eat food, it starts to knock it back down again, because it knows that the body's okay. It's in a fed state. If you go on an empty stomach and you go to the office and you're rushing around and you start getting stressed and you're on an empty stomach.
So there's a correlation between stress and the body trying to preserve itself, and it's like you said earlier, it'll use the muscles because that's less. It's like an emergency situation.
It's not a priority to keep muscle.
So you trick your body into thinking, if you starve yourself, your body starts to think you're in a survival mode, does it?
Yeah. People absolutely, excuse my French, but their metabolism by cutting the calories right down too quickly. In fact, while you're on the subject of hormones and fat loss, I just quickly run into this. About 10 years ago, maybe 15 years ago now, they discovered a hormone called leptin. And it was named leptin because that's the Greek, it means thin in Greek, okay? So leptin levels, when they're high, your metabolism's high.
Yeah.
When leptin levels go down, your fat burning abilities and your metabolism slows down, right? Now, leptin levels are released according to what amount of food you're eating. So if you're eating, say you're used to eating 3,000 calories a day, roughly, that amount of food, roughly, and then suddenly you go on a diet and you go down to 1,500 calories a day, by the end of that week, your leptin levels would have dropped by half, which means your metabolism would have slowed right down. Mm. Sure enough, eventually, if you carry on, you're going to start losing body fat because your body doesn't have enough food to keep to that level of body fat, but you've done it in a really, really unhealthy, hard way.
Right.
You've slowed your metabolism down and starved yourself. It's not good. You don't need to do that.
So what's your eating habits then? What do you eat every day?
I eat regular portions, like I sent you about snacking. Yeah. That's so many studies have shown that eating small portions, they call them meals, but a meal is a bit misleading because we think of a big plate of food as being a meal. So we call it snacks. So I don't ever really have a meal.
Right.
I snack.
I see.
I just constantly snack, and I'll have about 5 or 6 snacks throughout the day. Like for breakfast, as soon as I wake up, I'll have a pint of water just to rehydrate my body.
Yeah.
And then after about 10 minutes, I'll get some natural yogurt, bio yogurt, and I'll mix in some scoop of whey protein with that and maybe some other bits and bobs, mix that up. I'll have that. That's a very small snack. And then about 3 hours later, or I've scrambled eggs on a couple of pieces of granary. And throughout the day, I'm just snacking. And even come the evening, I'll just have some meat and some salad.
Right. Okay. Yeah, this is making sense now. So basically, the worst thing you could do is like nothing in the morning, coffee up until midday, and then a big plate of food at night.
Yeah.
That's just
going
to be a catastrophe. But it's better to have just regular healthy snacks sort of constantly.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Even if it's a handful of shelled nuts.
Yeah.
And I mean, if you're a bodybuilder, you're gonna want to bump up the protein a little bit more. It is relative. If you've been training hard, you're gonna want more protein, and you're gonna feel like it. If you feel like you're recovered, then you're not gonna need so much protein. But it's best to keep, if you keep your snacks protein based, that's shown again to speed your metabolism up.
Yeah.
Which keeps your body temperature a lot higher.
Right. In a minute, I want to ask you about pH stuff, and I want to ask you some stuff about, our mutual friend Chris Hole. He's big on that type of thing. But first, I wanted to show you my Aldi nuts, my mixed nuts that they sell in Aldi. It's got seeds, like sunflower seeds and pumpkin seeds and cashews and almonds and walnuts. And is that okay, do you think, like as a snack?
Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah.
That's, Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
The one thing I would advise against with stuff like that is dried fruit.
Right.
Because dried fruit, sometimes they even add sugar to dried fruit. But of course, you know, think of dried fruit, what it is originally, and then how shrunken it is. And then you chuck a handful of that in your mouth. That's like eating a massive amount of fruit sugar.
Right.
Fruit sugar actually is even worse for normal sugar for storing body fat. I won't go into the details why, okay. But fruit sugar is worse for normal sugar. And normal sugar is bad enough.
Okay. All right. Yeah.
If you're going to eat fruit, here's a golden rule for you. One piece of fruit at one time. On an empty stomach.
Okay.
That's it. Okay. If you have a fruit, if you see people on diets, they have a fruit salad.
Yeah.
It's the worst thing you could do. You're better off having a chocolate bar.
Okay.
They're serious.
All right. Okay. All right. Well, maybe we'll go into that in more detail another time. But we'll take you at your word on that. So I just remember what I was going to ask you. What's your thoughts on vegan lifestyle, bodybuilding, I mean, and protein? What's your thoughts on that?
I've looked into it quite a bit because I would now I'll try and keep this basic and simple as possible. I've looked for evidence of you do get some reasonable vegetarian bodybuilders, and the best ones I've found got big, built the size, and then turned vegetarian. I've never seen one that's gone all the way through as a vegetarian. And vegan is even harder. This comes down to the types of proteins. Protein is a loose term. It's a macronutrient. It's a type of food. But protein is made up of generally about 22 different types of main proteins. So there's 22 different types. They're called amino acids. That's the single blocks of protein. Okay. Out of those 22 amino acids, there's about three or four that are really, really beneficial for muscle growth. The rest do other things around the body that aren't really involved in muscle growth.
Okay.
And unfortunately, like the top four, glutamine and the free branched chain amino acids, aren't in such high quantities in vegetarian sources.
Right.
So you'll get a vegan bodybuilder or a vegetarian bodybuilder, and they're taking in lots of protein. But the amino acids or the type of proteins that they need aren't actually in such high quantities. So then they've got all these extra amino acids that their body can't make any use out of.
Right.
So it's going to turn to body fat.
Oh, I see.
Too much protein in one go is still going to not get used for its purpose, and it's still going to get turned to body fat.
Oh, I see. Okay.
My philosophy is balance. You know, you're talking about Chris and pH. Well, I found that if I've alkalized my diet too much, my testosterone goes down. I go weak. I feel ill. I feel a bit insipid. And then I go back the other way, and then I don't feel quite so healthy. And the balance is to, well, if you're going to have some meat, then make sure you have some alkaline stuff with it. Do you know what I mean? The body works so much better when things are in balance. Vegan food is brilliant. It's so nutritious if you're eating like nuts, seeds, and salad and leaves and stuff like that. It's brilliant for the body, but it doesn't have stuff in it that meat has.
Right. Oh, I see. That's interesting because, you know, vegans or vegetarians, they're often kind of skinny and kind of they often don't look great, do they? You know,
I haven't seen a healthy one yet.
and so, I mean, I was on Facebook earlier and there was this thing and it said all these vegetables have got all these different proteins in, and broccoli and everything. So you're saying that it might have protein, but it might not be the right type of protein that your body needs.
And also some of those things I've seen what they say about the amount how much it's got in it per pound and whatever. Well, if you actually did a quick mathematical thing, you'd have to eat a table full of what they're talking about to get the amount of protein that you'd get in a steak.
Right.
You see what I mean? So and it's the one I hear is the gorilla analogy. Well, the gorilla eats each vegetable. Yeah, but have you seen how much he eats? And have you looked at his genetic type? It's completely different to our genetic type.
Right. So a gorilla sits there all day eating bad food.
All day.
Right?
I mean, go to the zoo and see what they're feeding them.
Right. So I see. So, okay. So in other words, basically, just to put it simply, there's a lot more protein in a slab of meat, you know, let's just say good quality meat, than there. You'd have to eat a whole table full of greens to get that.
At the end of the day, a good steak is a lump of muscle. If you've trained really hard down the gym, you've broken down your muscle. One of the best foods, and any bodybuilder would tell you this, they feel recovered, they feel strong, and they feel brilliant after eating some muscle to replace the muscle that they've broken down and need to rebuild.
Well, yeah, you know, it's funny you should say that, because I've noticed if I ignored everything everybody told me about anything and just listen to my own body, I know that I feel a bit better after I've had the occasional bit of meat, you know, or a burger or something, or just, like, if I don't have those things, I end up feeling not so great, you know?
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, I watched an interesting interview the other day, and it was two young men in their early 20s, so their testosterone levels should be ridiculously sky high, and they're very healthy, and they went on a vegan diet, and they said the first 2 or 3 weeks, they felt amazing. Their skin was clear, their energy was sky high, and they just felt really happy, emotionally really good, and after 3 months of being on this very, very, very healthy vegan diet, it wasn't like, oh, this is a vegan cake, this is a vegan beef burger. It wasn't that. It was proper healthy food. They had no sex drive. No sex drive in their early 20s, young, yeah, healthy men.
Yeah.
And one night, that one of the dads said, look, for God's sake, kids, just have a piece of wild salmon. It's fresh water wild salmon. You can't get any more natural than this. Eat it. And like this guy says, I ate this salmon. And he said, and the next day I woke up for the first time with an erection.
Yeah.
And they were talking to his dietitian, and he was saying, well, why is that? And he's saying, because of what's in meat, saturated fat is the main building block for your body to use to make good cholesterol that your body needs to make your hormones,
right,
especially testosterone,
yeah,
along with the certain amino acids and the certain proteins and the vitamins and the minerals, the building blocks needed by your body to make those anabolic androgenic hormones.
Yeah, that's really interesting. There's definitely a correlation between guys that don't eat meat, and you can see they've got no aggression. I don't mean aggression like in a negative way, but just like, just you know what I mean, right?
Yeah, definitely.
So it's not just about like bodybuilding and stuff. You, like, a bloke needs kind of testosterone just to be normal, doesn't he?
A bloke. Yeah. I think there's a problem these days with men. They seem to be more kind of wimpy and more effeminate.
Yeah.
It seems to be a role reversal going on. I don't know if you've noticed that.
Yeah, totally. I mean, that's a whole conversation for another time.
Yeah,
I know what you mean. So let's talk more about you and what you do. So if people are watching this and they want some coaching or something, what's the best way to get in contact with you?
I think for now, the best way to get in contact with me is just to send me an email.
Yeah.
You can go to my website and contact me through jadacastellari.com, or you can just send me an email at jada@jadacastellari.com.
Okay.
Or you can find me on Facebook.
Yeah, okay. And you do coaching over Skype and over the telephone?
Yeah, I do coaching over Skype, yeah.
And
I do it on Skype because I can record it on Skype and then they can have a copy of it afterwards.
Yeah, yeah. And there's advantages as well, isn't it? Like, you could speak to someone the other side of the world, you know, without them needing to travel and stuff.
Skype's brilliant, man.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Yeah. Oh, it's incredible. I love it. Yeah, I mean, you know.
It's free.
Yeah.
What can you say?
So what's your goals? Like, what are you working on at the moment then, Jada?
At the moment, I'm actually finishing off some products which are going towards the personal training market,
yeah,
for personal trainers to teach them bodybuilding.
Right.
Because at the moment, there's no official bodybuilding qualification in the personal training industry.
Yeah.
So everybody goes to a personal trainer pretty much to get in shape. The problem is personal trainers, as a rule, unless they do their own private study, don't know what bodybuilders know.
Right.
And bodybuilders are the world's leading experts, whether we like to admit it or not, in building muscle and losing body fat, which in basic terms means changing the shape of your body.
Yeah.
And I don't even like the word bodybuilding because it has so much stigma attached to it and negative connotations of these big beef heads taking steroids. But of course, you've got natural bodybuilding as well, which is a completely different kettle of fish. But bodybuilders are the world's experts.
Yeah. 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 Oh, right. So if people do like a regular fitness, what do you call it, personal trainer course, they're not necessarily going to learn the type of stuff
Unfortunately not. There is no, I mean, I spoke to a personal trainer today and he's gone on the advanced course, which he paid £3,500 for. And he actually showed me the bit where they touch on bodybuilding. And I just laughed and said, well, that's no good to anyone. He said, well, exactly.
Right.
It's no good. But that's not what they're taught. They're taught all kinds of stuff like core stability and Well, Chris will be, vouch for this. He'd be a good person to talk to. But that, yeah, there's no one specific doing what I'm doing yet.
Right. So you're going to specialize in teaching personal trainers muscle building stuff like what we've been talking about today.
Yeah, the basic fundamentals that can be replicated over and over and over and over again.
Right. Okay. So when are you going to begin doing that? Because there might be people that are listening to this that would be interested.
My time scale is about 3 to 4 months for completion of the website. So the I've got 3 products. 2 are pretty much built and are in beta stage.
Okay. So this will be probably ready to go start of 2013 kind of thing,
yeah,
isn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
As if the world doesn't end.
Yeah. Right, okay. So basically, if people just keep an eye on your website, and you got a Facebook page as well?
If anyone's interested in anything I talk about, just go to my Facebook page and request Jada Castellari.
Okay. Jada, I don't know what to say. Thank you so much for your time. You've taught me loads of stuff that I was doing wrong. That seems obvious to me now, but it wasn't.
I'll tell you what I'm going to do for you, Ben. I'm going to send you part of my strength training product, which is for personal trainers. It's quite advanced, but you're an intelligent guy. So I'm going to send you that on email later so you can read through that. And if you want to do another video after you've read through it, just to check you understand it, then you can get straight on with your strength training.
Brilliant. That's really nice of you. It's really good.
And Christmas has come early.
Yeah. I hope this has been useful for the people that are going to be watching this as well. They can put their comments on the YouTube video and stuff. And I hope people will get in contact with you if they want to ask more questions. And I don't know. Is there anything you want to finish up? Any final comments before we wrap up?
Nah, if you ask me to carry on, I'll go on all night, Ben. It's best to leave it there.
Yeah, I think you've given me plenty to think about for the time being. So maybe we'll come back another time, and maybe we'll see what type of feedback we get from this call, we'll do another one at some point.
Yeah, be cool.
That's brilliant.
Good, Ben.
All right, thanks so much, Jada. That was awesome.
All right, take care.
All right,
cheers, mate.
Cheers.
Bye bye.